Today's Curiosity Teardown is assisted by Stone Angel Brewing Company's Three Jolly Bargemen English Dark Mild Ale. They describe it as a silky, smooth, unpretentious session-strength ale with notes of toasted hazelnuts, chocolate, and coffee. So how many of you recognize this device? This is a touch-tone coder, ACC588, from the Codaphone Company. What this device does is to allow you to send DTMF tones over a phone that doesn't have a touch tone or DTMF encoder on it. So for like old dial style phones and whatnot. And the reason the Codaphone Company made this was because a lot of the early telephone answering machines, you use touch tone, DTMF, to control them so that you could listen to your messages remotely. This was, of course, at a time long before voicemail was invented, and if you wanted to record messages that people left on your phone when you weren't at home, you needed a specific separate machine. So the purpose of today's exercise is to tear this down and see what's inside it. Let's start with batteries. Looks like it wants three of them. These ones are old and crusty, so we'll get them out of the way. Eef. Don't know if I'll be able to make it work on batteries or not, because there's a lot of crud in there. I may just clip on leads once it's opened up just to get some power into it to play with it. I don't really feel like messing with those. Anyway, four screws on the back of it. In we go. Oof, those are tight. Just need the right tool for the job to get these loosened up, because they probably haven't moved in 50 years, I would guess. Interesting to see which era this is from, when it was manufactured. I'm going to guess late 70s, early 80s, but we'll see what the date is on some of the chips. Or on the one chip, because that's really all there is in here. We have the speaker output there. We have power here, a couple of jumper wires, three capacitors, one resistor, one crystal for frequency reference, and the main chip, which is a UM9559E. And if I'm reading that right, it's the 52nd week of 1988 is the manufacture date of that chip. The board design is from 1987. And other than that, we just have the standard little resistive rubber button carbon things to act as push buttons on the front here. Wow, really nothing to it. This data sheet looks like a scan of a fax from 1975. What do we know about it? Low output tone distortion, 7%. Wouldn't really call 7% low, but I guess for what it's doing, it doesn't really need to be any closer than that. It'll run on anything from 2.5 to 10 volts. Well, that's useful information. It could run it on a 9-volt battery. Uses a standard TV crystal, 3.58 megahertz, to derive all of its frequencies. Yeah, so that is the color burst crystal for an old analog television system in North America. And being a standard television crystal, that would mean that they are incredibly available and incredibly cheap just due to economies of scale. And also designed to interface directly with a standard telephone push button or a standard calculator type XY keyboard. And how that is set up is the button inputs are here. Row 1, row 2, row 3, row 4, column 1, column 2, column 3, and column 4. So when you join a row with a column, it can figure out internally where on your keypad you've hit. But also, with four rows and four columns, that means that there are 16 total combinations. So here are all of the standard tones for the row and the column. And then the D in DTMF, the dual tone. So row 1, column 1 switch pushed would create both 697 and 1209 hertz and combine them together into a single output of those dual frequencies, those two frequencies. And this guy's not using analog tone generators. It's all digitally synthesized. So it's not even a perfect sine wave. It's just quantized output like that, approximating a sine wave. Here is an example schematic of it integrated into an actual telephone circuit. You've got your receiver and your mic, receiver being the speaker that you listen to, mic being the one you talk to, obviously. This 500 network is just a very standard telephony voice network that does two-wire to four-wire conversion. There's your tip and ring that goes out to the telephone network. Bridge rectifier and a Zener diode to create the power supply for the thing. The tone output going through this transistor to drive the line. The mute output from this thing, which is probably not being used on the device we got on our bench, but it would turn on or shut off the microphone so that the tones wouldn't be getting combined with noise in the room to confuse the decoder at the other end. There is the keypad connected, and there is our reference crystal. It's a very standard high-volume chip that was used in every telephone that had touch tones on it, pretty much, or some variant of it. Very standardized, designed to be used with very few support components. Simple, effective, and pretty much obsolete these days. So let's connect up the power supply. That's the positive most side of the battery. The negative most side is down in there, but I traced it and it goes to the black wire of the speaker. So, put 4.5 volts on it. It's drawing like negligible current. So if we push a button on this side, can you hear that? Let me pull it up closer to the microphone of the phone here. Standard DTMF tones, exactly what you would expect out of it. So just as an experiment, let's take a look at a few things using the scope. So I'll connect the one probe onto one side of the crystal and push a button. And there is the oscillator activated, which is that 3.58 megahertz, which is what the crystal's generating. So it looks like it only lights up the crystal or any of the circuit when there's a button being pushed. And that makes sense too, because there's no current being drawn unless there's a button being pushed. Even when there is, it's such a low current that you can't even measure it. And for a battery powered device, I guess that makes sense that it's drawing as little current as possible, except for when you're actually pushing a button and telling it to do something. And then if we connect the scope to pin 16, which is the tone out pin, and try a few tone pairs, you can see the two frequencies being mixed together. Another neat trick with most DTMF pads is if you push both buttons in a column or both buttons in a row, you'll get an actual single tone of just that column. So here's two row buttons together. Here's the next row down. Third row. Fourth row, there's two from the first column, two from the second column, two from the third column. You can use a touch tone keypad as a signal generator if you need to in a pinch. Although remembering that it was, what did it promise? 7% distortion, and it is just a digitized sine wave. It's not an actual analog synthesized sine wave. But still, if you're in a pinch, it's nice to it's a nice trick to have up your sleeve. Now I think I'm just going to spend a couple of minutes and reverse engineer this. We know it's going to be very close to that demo schematic that we found, but I'd like to see just exactly how close it is. So give me a couple of minutes and I will be back with the schematic for you shortly. Well, that was pretty straightforward and pretty much exactly what I expected, even simpler than the sample schematics in the datasheet. We have power coming in here, plus and minus voltages from 3 1.5 volt batteries in series. For completeness, those are type 389 batteries, but I bet you an LR44 would fit in there just fine. And then we have just a power supply stabilizing smoothing capacitor, C3 47 microfarad, that one down there. And we have the chip itself with its crystal on pin 7 and 8, again expected, that's where it should be based on the data sheet. Then we have pin 16, which is the audio output, the tone output, going through a 270 ohm resistor straight to the speaker. Presumably that is just to prevent from loading down the chip too badly. The sample schematics in the data sheet both showed a transistor on the output, so that's likely what that guy is doing. Then we have a couple of capacitors here from the positive, or from the audio output, I guess, of the speaker. 0.1 microfarad electrolytic going up to the positive, and 0.1 nanofarad going down to the negative, that is ceramic. And that's all the components. There's three capacitors, one resistor, and the crystal, then the chip, and four lines going out to the rows, three lines going to the column. Pin 6, which is the fourth column, is not used in this application because we don't have the extra row of keys there. I'm sorry, the extra column. And that extra column would be labeled A, B, C, D, and would be used for not in telephony, not in normal telephony. They would be used for commands and whatnot. A lot of times, touch tone is also used to remote control various other devices. A radio station I used to work for years ago had a remote control for our transmitter to power up, power down, change from transmitter A to transmitter B, move from day to night pattern, that was controlled by DTMF as well. And it did use those extra ones, so way back then I carried a similar thing, but with the extra four buttons on it, that could control that. Actually, I just remembered, I have this old device, which I did a video on a long time ago. I'll put a link to that up in the corner. And it actually has the full keypad that has the ABCD, which generates four extra tone pairs for remote controlling stuff. But as I said, in this case, that's not used. So that's a fairly simple device. Not much more to say about it. It's a device who had its time, and its time is now long past. Well, I hope you found that interesting. I hope a few of you old timers found that a bit of a trip down memory lane. Thanks for watching. As always, questions or comments down below in the comment section. I'll talk to you later.